We are going to begin with a review of vectors. You have encountered vectors in many courses. They have always been introduced as if it was obvious how to represent a vector and how to work with vectors. It was anything but obvious. With Isaac Newton, a whole host of vectorial entities entered into physical science, but not the concept of a vector. There was force, velocity, and acceleration. From 1790 to 1850, there were more than 10 vector systems introduced. I am so comfortable and familiar with our modern-day representation of vectors that I can't even think of how else we would do it. By the middle 1800s, the most popular system was something called quaternions, and this was something that was a combination of a scalar plus a vector. Quaternions were invented by William Rowan Hamilton. Hamilton is probably Ireland's most famous scientist. He developed a reformulation of Newtonian mechanics, which is now referred to as Hamiltonian mechanics, and it was important in the development of quantum mechanics. Our modern system of vector representation and analysis was independently developed by Josiah Gibbs at Yale and Oliver Heaviside in London. Since Gibbs and Heaviside's system of vector representation and analysis was conceptually simpler and notationally cleaner, it displaced the use of quaternions over the period of 1880 to 1910. Quaternions still have some niche applications, such as in describing spatial rotations. Much later in the course, we'll see that Heaviside used his vector system to recast the 20 equations that James Clerk Maxwell used into the four equations we refer to today as Maxwell's equations. So our modern vector system that is always presented as if it was obvious took over 100 years to develop. A scalar is a quantity that only has a magnitude. Examples of scalars are volume, temperature, electric potential, speed, charge, current, and energy. A vector is a quantity that has both a magnitude and a direction. Examples of vectors are force, velocity, electric and magnetic field intensities, and current density. In this course, we are going to be working with fields, and you can have a scalar field or a vector field. So a field is a function that specifies a particular quantity everywhere in a region. So for instance, we could have an electric potential field, which is a scalar field, or an electric field intensity, which is a vector field. We will represent a vector with an arrow, and the length of that vector will be the magnitude, and of course, the direction it's pointing will be the direction of the vector. Now, it will be useful to introduce the concept of a unit vector, and a unit vector is just a vector of magnitude 1 that is pointing in the direction of our vector. So we can represent our vector as the magnitude times our unit vector, a hat. And I will write that vector as A with an arrow over it. In text, such as your book or on an exam, the vector won't be represented with an arrow on top, but it will be represented as a bold quantity. Now, the negative of a vector we will think of as a vector of the same length but pointing in the opposite direction. So if this is vector A, this would be vector minus A. If I draw a series of lines like this, it will be signifying a vector field which is pointing to the right. Sometimes I want to represent a vector field coming out of the page, and I will signify that with dots like this. If I want to signify a vector field going into the page, I will do that with X's. To remember this, think of an arrow. If the arrows are coming at you, you see the points signifying the vector field is coming at you. If the arrow is going away from you, you see the tail feathers. So the X's represent the vector field going into the page. Let's apply a force of 5 newtons to some object and let the direction of that force be in the A hat direction. So this object will accelerate given by the force is equal to the mass times the acceleration. Let's set up an XY coordinate system such that this rectangle has the force as its diagonal. This side of our rectangle will be of length 4, and this side of our rectangle will be of length 3. A sub x is the unit vector pointing in the positive x direction, and a sub y is the unit vector pointing in the positive y direction. You would find that you would get the same acceleration for the object if you simultaneously applied 4 newtons in the x direction and 3 newtons in the y direction as you did from applying 5 newtons in the a hat direction. That means fx plus fy is equivalent to f. This gives us a method of representing a vector by its components in the x and y directions. Since the magnitude of f will be the length of this diagonal, we can use the Pythagorean theorem for this right triangle here, where the diagonal is the hypotenuse, f sub x is one side, and f sub y is the other side, to find f. So f is going to equal the square root of f sub x squared plus f sub y squared. If we are working in 3 dimensions, then we would also have a z component. And the magnitude would be the square root of f sub x squared plus f sub y squared plus f sub z squared. If you want to find the unit vector in the direction of the force vector, you just take your force vector and divide by the magnitude of the force vector. Let's look at 2 vectors that are not parallel and the angle between them is something other than 90 degrees. If these are force vectors applied to an object, we would see some acceleration for that object. We think of the sum of vector f1 plus f2 as the vector we could replace f2 and f1 with and observe the same acceleration. If we form the parallelogram where f1 and f2 are the 2 sides of the parallelogram, then the diagonal turns out to be the vector you could replace f1 and f2 with and get the same acceleration for this object. So here we have a graphical method for summing 2 vectors. Another way to think of this graphical addition of 2 vectors is with this triangle right here. So we place f1 and then we place the tail of f2 at the tip of f1, and the third side of the triangle would be f, the sum of f1 plus f2. Now that we know how to graphically add 2 vectors, let's look at how we would mathematically add 2 vectors. Here we have our XY coordinate system. So this distance right here will be the X component of F sub 2. This distance will be the X component of F sub 1. And this distance will be the X component of our vector F, which is the sum of vectors F1 and F2. So we see that the sum of the x components of f1 and f2 is the x component of our vector f. If we write f1 and f2 in component form, then the sum of f1 and f2 are just the sums of each individual component. Let's look at how we would think of subtracting two vectors. Here we have vector A and vector B. If this is vector B, then vector minus B would be this vector. Same length, but pointing in the opposite direction. We will think of A minus B as adding to vector A the vector minus B. So our graphical technique, we would add minus B to A to obtain A minus B. Here we have B in component form. To get minus B, we just take the negative of this. So to form A minus B, we just add the components of A and minus B. So the x component of A minus B will be A sub x minus B sub x, the y component A sub y minus B sub y, and the z component A sub z minus B sub z. When we multiply a vector by a scalar, we will think of that as increasing the magnitude of the vector by that scalar factor. So each component of the vector will be multiplied by the scalar factor k in this case. Here is a table from your textbook showing the properties of vector addition and multiplication by a scalar. You can verify any of these vector identities by writing the vectors in component form and evaluating the two sides of the equations. Let's now define what we mean by a position vector of a point in space. The magnitude of the position vector will be the distance from the origin to that point in space, and the direction will be the direction pointing from the origin to that point. So for the point 3, 4, 5, the position vector will be 3 in the x direction, plus 4 in the y direction, plus 5 in the z direction. Here we have two points, point P and point Q, and the position vectors R sub P for point P and R sub Q for point Q. If we want to find the distance vector, that is the vector whose magnitude is the distance between P and Q and whose direction is the direction from P to Q, we see that it's just RQ minus R sub P. We'll find position vectors are useful when we want to find the electric field intensity when we have multiple point charges. The location of each point charge will be identified by its position vector.